to the panel entitled Taking It to the Next Level. And the idea was, you know, we're hearing a lot about today about startups and really early stage companies. And what I actually wanted to do was talk about kind of the next level. So people build companies and start from zero, start from somewhere. But really the goal, both from an investor point of view and a entrepreneur point of view, is to take it to the next level, build a very, very big company. But I wanted to first start with, first of all, thanking my esteemed panel here. I'm not going to introduce any of them. I want to really introduce myself. Before I do that, and thank them, I just want to say a word of thanks to everybody who's here today. And anybody who's here last year, you may remember that when I was sitting in the seat last year, unfortunately, I was sitting in a wheelchair and had been post two operations and a car accident. And so today, as I'm walking around, lots of people are coming up and saying, "Wow, it's great to see you walking. And it's great to just be able to impress people by walking. So you don't have to build big companies, you don't have to do anything else, just walk." So that's great. It's great to be here. So what I'd love to do is just take, everybody just take 30 seconds, literally. Please introduce yourselves, where you're from, what you do. And Aaron, since you, you get the reward for traveling the farthest to get here, you get to start.
You guys hear me? Aaron LaPat. I run an executive search firm in the U.S. called Park Square. We're in Boston and San Francisco. We help investors and their portfolio companies recruit at the board and the senior leadership level. So we do executive level recruiting, CEOs, heads of the various functions, and work in tech and healthcare primarily. Say three quarters of our work is in the U.S. and a quarter is international. And by reference to traveling, the furthest I came here via Tokyo, which is fortunate because if I were on the East Coast, I wouldn't have made it.
Thanks, Eric.
I'm Mark Resnick, a partner at Fortissimo Capital Fund. We're a private equity fund. We manage four funds. We raised about $1 billion. We invested in maturing companies, helping them get to the next level. Companies that are basically in technology and industrial sectors, and we like to take significant stakes so that we can have impact on our companies.
Rando Bachano, partner in Tango since 96, doing venture capital, early stage investment sometimes, and also doing a growth stage. Tango is managing close to $1.7 billion so far with full venture fund only, with occasional growth fund investment. Recently, we launched our growth fund, $250 million, you know, along the lines of the projects we are going to talk with. On the other side, we also go as early as possible. We are managing an incubator for digital media in Haifa. We co-founded SOSA, the town square of the ecosystem in Tel Aviv. So I think that the message of Titango is for early stage people.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Amir Berger. I'm a general partner in Jar Ventures Fund. We invest in companies after the entry stage, probably prior to round A. We invest typically $1 to $2 million in companies which already have revenue and customers. In my previous life, I've been an angel investor. I've one of the shoulders in two incubators, technology incubators, deliver, and I'm a co-founder of a company called the Lanzatite Network. I've been there in two cycles of my life. In my life cycle, I was chairman and CEO for quite a few years, and left there like the end of the day.
Hi, I'm Gary Epstein. I am the senior chair of the Global Corporate Securities Department. I am the co-head with Bob Grossman of the Israel practice and managing partner of our Tel Aviv office. Since you heard Bob talk about the firm, I think I'm just going to talk about my grandchildren. I was more interested in what the Bank of Cook had to say, because apparently with all their billions of dollars, they just figured out that what Israel needed was a bridge after spending time on an incubator and an accelerator. We had that idea over 10 years ago. We started coming to Israel in order to introduce Israeli companies to our client base, and it was so successful, Bezrat Hashem, that we eventually became the first major international firm to open a registered legal office in Tel Aviv, and you are all welcome to visit 30th floor Amidal HaGol Azrieli.
Thanks a lot, Gary. Thanks a lot to all of you. So, as we think about taking it to the next level and building big companies, I think one of the things that I've learned as an investor and helping invest in, raise money for, and build companies over the years is that one of the most important things, and I know it's going to sound cliche, is that investing is really about people. And I think that's certainly true at the early stage. I think we often, if we decide not to invest in a particular company, often it's we love the technology, we love the idea, but maybe we just think they're just not the right people. And oftentimes it's the opposite. Maybe the idea is not fully baked, but the people are just top-notch. That's a great investment. But I want to talk about it kind of at another level, which is as you're scaling a company and building a company and thinking about going big, how do you find the right people? How do you keep the right people? And how do you recruit them appropriately? So actually, I want to start out, Aaron, with you. Aaron, you spend, we all spend part of what we do on people. I believe that's kind of all you do, is find the right people for others. You've built your own business too, so find the right people for your own business. But how do you, first of all, recruit them and find them, particularly in the environment which we've been in, which is a bull market, at least until a few weeks ago, we'll see, but really a bull market for people. Both here in Israel, and I was actually in San Francisco last week, prices for people, if you will, salaries, equity, the demand, how do you deal with that and enable companies to find the right people to kind of fill the right pieces of the puzzle to build the company?
Yeah, hiring great people matters at every stage. From startup, where it's really important to make sure you're partnering with great founders, to growth stage, to mature stage, and we get involved at varying stages to help companies recruit people. In fact, we have clients that we've done work for over an extended period of time where we're recruiting senior leadership for that has a unique skill set for a particular stage of development for that company. With the old adage, different horses for different courses, there are, as companies grow and mature, some senior leaders are able to evolve with the business, and others are better in different roles, and new senior people come in. We're doing work for a company in Boston that's speech recognition technology. I knew them when they were a startup. They're now a $100 million company. We're recruiting a CTO who will oversee the entire technical enterprise, overseeing the current VP of engineering, who's staying. He's a fantastic guy. He just has now a very large global technology organization, and managing technology in that company today is very different from what it was 3 or 4 years ago. Recruiting top talent is always hard. In a bull or bear market, finding great people is challenging because the best people need to be recruited. Great people are always hard to find, and you need to be deliberate, you need to be thoughtful, you need to be proactive, and take the process seriously. We see a lot of firms that wind up trying to rush through, trying to get an easy answer so they can move on from the process of recruiting to running your business. And while we completely empathize with that, it is one of the more important decisions you will make. So being deliberate about it really matters.
I have no experience in human resources. investors, as they invest in company and as you build the capital structure of a company, it's extraordinarily important that you keep in mind that you're going to need to reward the people there is talking about. There be an appropriate bonus pool, that there be a way for management as the various rounds, dilutive rounds come in. There's going to be a way to keep people motivated and interested. And just a second, what you just said, as someone who, a firm who just recruited Rudy Giuliani, a guy like Rudy Giuliani doesn't have to change firms. He has to be excited by the prospect of building something and being a part of something and making a huge contribution. And of course, he needs to think that there's going to be the wherewithal to appropriately compensate him, which is something that needs to be brought up almost immediately after the angel round, in every round. And I think, Mark, you would, the way you do an acquisition, would bear that out.
Right, if I can add to what Gary said, actually, you know, it's important to recruit the right people, but you also want to retain the right people. And it's not just about the money. And compensation maybe is one component, but people want to feel happy about where they go to work. And it's very important that you set the right corporate culture. You know, people want to contribute, they want to go home at night and say, wow, I really did something interesting and fun today, and I'm needed. And quite often when we have strategic sessions with companies, we invite middle management to come and hear what they have to say, and then they also take ownership over whatever needs to be implemented. So that's very important. We brought our CEO to a company once, and we thought he was doing a phenomenal job, and then two senior R&D guys came to us and said, either we go or he goes. And then we realized that he was trying to implement change too quickly and really just totally changed the entire corporate culture, and it was a disaster internally. So we ended up getting rid of him, even though we thought he was doing a good job, and we took someone internally to replace him, and things have been going a lot smoother.
Maybe, Rami, before you jump in, I wanted to actually address something with you on this, and maybe Mark as well. When you look to invest in a company, it's Series A or let's say beyond, and there are founders there, and probably they're Series A level, they're doing a pretty good job already. But do you already have other people in mind? Are you already thinking, hey, we need to add a COO, we need to add a president, and are you already looking for those right people already, or is it kind of a gradual evolutionary process?
So since we are early stage investors, we don't recruit people. We choose entrepreneurs, and it's a mutual process. They need to choose us, and it's a dance, and you need to build chemistry. And when I look at those people, I'm saying I only want one test, because I'm very limited, so I only want one test. I say, does he know what he's doing? And if the guy knows what he's doing, then, you know, he passed the test. And knows what he's doing means a lot. Means that he knows to build a team, that he actually came with a team, and that he's actually the first one to say, Houston, I mean, the board, we have a problem. And I don't want to be in a situation where I invest in someone that I tell him, listen, I'm Houston, you have a big problem. And I think that a perfect CEO will say, Houston, we have a problem, even before the problem has been identified as one. So we, as early stage investor, we want to be in a situation where we invest in would-be CEOs for as long as possible. We want them to build a company for growth and to succeed, even if it's first time to entrepreneur. Actually, in Pitango 6, our latest fund, we have, out of 18 investments, we have 5 serial entrepreneurs of Pitango. So people that were first time entrepreneurs, they built companies, they exited them, and then, you know, we were able to retain them and bring them back, and for us, this is a huge success.
I understand, you know, Rami at the earlier stage, and when I was involved in venture capital, I know we also invested in people, basically not in companies, because, you know, in early stage, you're going to have to, you know, switch course, and you want someone who can really navigate through the issues. We're investing in more mature companies, companies that have, you know, several hundred employees, tens of millions of dollars in revenues, and we have no problem investing in a company and then bringing the proper management. And quite often, when we're doing diligence, we actually have several people lined up, and they would help us, assist us with doing diligence with an eye toward potentially taking a senior role in the company so that they learn about the company as we do, and then they say, you know what, I'm in love with this company, I can take this to the next level, and we bring them on board. Quite often we have to supplement, you know, senior management, VP, sales, R&D, as we're going along. You want to know that we have at least, you know, the active chairman or the CEO of the company with us once we close our transaction.
And we may not get past this question before the panel is over, but everyone is speaking from the investor side, from the company side. While everyone talks about investor due diligence, they're looking at the company, they're looking at management. Management needs to be looking at the investor, and they need to understand what they've done with management in the past and how the managers of their portfolio companies view them, and whether or not there are this is an add-on acquisition for another portfolio company for that investor, which means they don't need two CFOs. So this is something to think about.
Well, I can actually change that. If you want, I was asking to address a different question completely down the road. Go ahead.
Okay. Well, I think everyone said that how important it is to have a good CEO to run the company, which I totally agree, of course. And I think that VCs always tend to say when they do this, that the company will convince the company that they're good for them, and they will help them, and they will give them advice and all that. And we, I guess, tend to do the same by saying that we have lots of experience in running companies, so they should talk to us. But in reality, I think we should be modest enough being invested in that. Eventually, the success of the company is being determined by the quality of the team that you're invested in. In situations where you need to replace the upper-level management, it means that you've probably done a mistake unless you've done it consciously. You knew that the team is fantastic, only the CEO needs to be replaced. And I can tell you from my own history, Gilad was not only a company that was dealing with satellite communication and all that, which a few hundreds of million dollars in revenues, but also we had quite a few spin-offs. The biggest spin-off of Gilad, a company called GVT, Global Village Telecom, the company in Brazil, they do communication. And I'm fairly proud to say that the CEO who is running GVT nowadays, just to give you a perspective, GVT has been acquired by Telefonica, only Vendi, for $9 billion recently. Unfortunately for Gilad in the bad days had to sell his share at the prior stage. But the CEO of GVT is a guy named Amos Genish, and we've named Amos Genish, the CEO of this company, many years ago, while still under Gilad. And out of the companies that we are currently invested in, we don't know one example when we have invested in a company despite the fact that we did not like the CEO, and we had a CEO in mind, and we replaced the CEO and we're quite happy with our CEO. The exception to the rule.
So, I mean, Rob, I still wanted to change tack and move to the next question. We can continue to do this. So, Amiram was fairly modest, he introduced himself. Amiram was one of the founders of Gilad Satellite Networks in 1987. I actually first met Amiram in 1997, one of the first companies I got to know in Israel. The company grew to $500 million at its peak. And I guess, and Amiram, as he mentioned, sort of was part of Gilad in several different stages, has worked the company through really the ups, the big ups, and then the big downs, and then the up again, and the turnaround the company went through. I think I can say the company was literally at a certain point on the verge of bankruptcy after incredibly positive times, and then Amiram turned it around and turned it into a really profitable, successful business once again. And I guess what I wanted to talk to you, because you have experience that almost nobody in Israel has, in terms of taking a company number one from zero to almost $500 million. What are the things that you needed to do differently when you were an early stage company and then when you became a multi-hundred million dollar company? I believe it takes very different skill sets and priorities at the company. And then what did you have to do to make sure the company survived and rebuilt? Besides the financial engineering, I mean as a company and a culture, what did you have to do to make sure that happened?
It's kind of interesting. Okay, we were, if you like, lucky enough, or successful enough to take a company from a startup to an IPO, by the way, with the total amount of the company before the IPO was $3.5 million. And then when the company first went public, it was a valuation of about $100 million. And we were quite lucky that we took it all the way up, all the way down, and then lucky enough to take it up again. And I think that it's the same team, by the way, that was in the company, took the company through the IPO. And it's the same team that broke the company, if you like. So we have our share of mistakes. Don't make any mistake on me here. But I think that the conclusion, if you like, from all this journey, from the roller coaster is, every time it has its own fashion on why people are investing, the multiply and all that, which is in usually it's a growth, but now I think the fashion is growth, right? If you don't have 100% growth, then you're not really an interesting company. In other days, in bizarre days, it was eyeballs and the number of subscribers and all that. And from time to time, when the fashion changed, there are times that we go back to the old school of old economy. You actually need to have profit, and you need to make money. And most of the time when people are raising money, this is not really practical. So my lesson is, yeah, you can have to adapt yourself to the fashion, and if the fashion now is growth, okay, then you have to show growth, but keep yourself enough fuel for the strange day when it will change and you go back to old economy for a period of time until we forget and go back to some new criteria of how to live. This is my take out of this journey.
So let's talk about that for a minute. Maybe Rami and Mark are open it up. Are things changing? I agree with Rami around that. For the last couple of years, maybe more than two, three years, it's all been that growth again. Now, we're not back to the eyeballs of the 1999 period. I agree with that. But it's been all about growth, 100% growth. We can cover all kinds of new metrics, ARR, MRR, all kinds of things that we talk about. And I agree with you that there's no triple digits in that growth number that people kind of say, that's not interesting. You think things start to change? Do we start thinking about profitability again and sustainable businesses? What do you think about that?
First of all, I think that the evil industry lacked for a very long period of time a level that is called, quote, stage investments. It's like you go to McDonald's and you don't have the French fries. You know, it's basically wrong. Something is wrong here. So we had early stage funds that had to finance companies, you know, for a long time. And when an exit was in the horizon and someone was offering to buy the company was saying how much let's negotiate, and we hardly had a situation where companies would say no. No, we are not interested. So as long as the offer was not really like insulting, people would take it. Now we are in a stage that we have a very, very strong annual growth stage level. You know, we have, I think that the difference between 2013 and 2015 in terms of investment is over $1.5 billion in delta, and it's all growth investment. So there is room for growth, and venture, early stage venture capitalists know that if they have good companies, they can, you know, hand the stick to someone that is going to pick it up. Now, so this is one phenomenon. The other phenomenon is that you see people with a bigger appetite than before. People before wanted to tell the company. Now we are ready to go to the next level, and this is crucial. The barrier to be identified a few barriers. One barrier is what is called strategic acquisitions. There are over 300 multinational players here in Israel. Most of them, 90% of them, built their acquisitions. And those acquisitions were strategic for them. And strategic translates to evaluation that is completely unproportional to the state of the company. So
you have this problem too, I see.
So
you have this problem too.
And we have the problem, this problem too. If you want, like, I can even give you an example of Anubis, one of my companies that I was sure that it's a $1 billion company, and then Apple came too early and offered to buy the company. The company hardly had any revenues. It was NOV. And for $400 million, people were saying, I need to raise additional $100 million and start getting to revenues and growth and profitability, and maybe then I'll be worth something like that. So sometimes give me something that is completely out of scope. I need to be really optimistic in order to do that. So this is problem number one. Problem number two, for Israeli startups, we go slower than the US comparable startups. Like if you take two cars, like Peugeot GTI, like the Americans, they switch gears much faster. Gear is CSA, CSB, CSC. They get to a much higher momentum between one stage to the other. This builds confidence at their investors. Their investors have confidence. Look at this car. And the Israelis, we take our time between CSA and BMC in terms of performance. And this is reducing confidence. So when there is an acquisition offer coming up, we will say most probably yes. But recently we saw more and more companies that say no. Like Titanium have, except for ourselves. We have Border Free that we said no. We have Varonis that we said no. We have Fosca that nobody bothered to buy, so we had to continue. Also, true, because they have strong investors behind them, like in Border 3, they were strong investors, same thing in Toronis, Excel, and Evergreen, and Picando. So there was a pool of investors that said, continue. Another parameter.
So maybe, Mark, to you, just talk for a minute about valuation, Mark. I mean, you are different kinds of investors. You guys, I know you very well. You guys actually like some of the old-fashioned stuff that I'm there. I'm talking about profits, you know, businesses that are self-sustaining, big money. You come in later stages where that's really important to you. How have you been thinking about valuations kind of through the last 2-3 years where they've gotten maybe ahead of themselves? And how are you thinking about it now?
Well, I think definitely in the last 18 to 24 months, valuations were way out of whack with what we thought the company was worth. I think a lot of private companies were looking at the public markets and saying, well, look at our comps, look what they're trading at. But they didn't realize that they weren't at the same stage, they didn't have the same risk that a lot of these public companies have. And, you know, we would give a higher valuation to a company if they have recurring revenue, if they have double-digit growth, if they have a unique aspect to, you know, what they're offering. But quite often, there's still a major gap between what we would want to value a company at and what the entrepreneurs or the existing shareholders want. And sometimes we have to be creative with how we value a company. And what we've done recently, successfully actually, is, you know, the company, give an example, one company we invested in, there were many VC funds that were invested. The company was around for about 10 years, and a lot of the early stage investors couldn't invest anymore. The funds came to the end of their life where they didn't have additional investment capital. So we actually came in. We valued the company at about $30 million. The investor said, wait, this company is going to be sold in a year or two for over $100 million. We don't want you to set a benchmark at 30. So we came up with a creative structure where we actually said, okay, we'll take a 2.5 preference, meaning when we sell the company, we'll get 2.5 times our investment back first, and then the rest of the investors, you know, will split it and then have a catch up, and then we'll Viaduct pro rata. And if you're so confident the company will be sold at, in excess of $100 million, then you'll have, you know, you'll have a nice return and we'll have a nice return. And based on the risk reward, we said that we can do that. I think Gary would be happy that we actually also had provision there that we could force the sale after 2 years, because if you have a preference and then you have to take a vote, you're not a minority, they can say, well, we don't want to sell. So we could force the sale. And actually,
you must have had good lawyers.
Exactly, represent us in several transactions. We actually, 2 years later, we sold the company for $190 million, and we ended up, everybody, it was a win-win for everybody. So it's not a deal that we would typically go into, you know, if we already to do. However, if it's a company where we say, you know what, this really could be sold, it's a good company, you know, based on the risk reward ratio, then we would do that.
Once again, you're hearing from the perspective of the investors, and I'm going to go to the perspective of the company, and I start with an anecdote about my life, and you may not be here, but when we moved from Boston to Miami, we moved our lawnmower with us. When I was a student, I had time to cut the lawn. And as soon as we got to Miami, we saw A, it was too hot, and B, I had no time to cut the lawn, so we sat there in the garage, and we had a gardener. His name is Mr. Comer, and I said, you know, I'm going to really want to try to sell the lawnmower. She said, what should I ask? I said, I don't know, $25? So she went to Mr. Comer and said, would you like to buy our lawnmower? He said, you look at it, he looked at it, and he said, I'll give you $50. And she said, how about $25? That doesn't happen. So if valuations have gotten out of whack, the investors, by and large, unless you come up with a creative approach, are going to be very happy about it. The interesting thing about it, and this is where the creative part, you know, creatively getting to the next stage, a partner of mine says that the one sound you hear, and Rami sort of touched on this, that is common to every successful company, is the sound of the business plan being torn up. Because if you are rigid, especially in the early stages, you can't succeed. And you need to be attuned to what the market is telling you, to what the market is valuing. Can you shift your product to it, as Adam Stuckel, my technology partner, tells me, to a subscription level where you can sell recurring revenue? Can you do due diligence? And you can, because all the information is public. On what this strategic investor is looking for. Do they have a great distribution system into which your product would fit? Are they looking, and again, this is not good for the Israeli economy, but it may be good for the individual company, for one piece of R&D that fills a gap in their offering. Again, as the seller, as the product, as the entrepreneur, you need to be constantly evaluating the market, evaluating the buyers, and reinventing your company around the resources that you have.
Gary, yeah, you might be a lawyer if you're not in this sophisticated deep, right? But I give you my perspective, my also to you. I think that I'm coming from a conservative school in the sense that the reaction should be in a successful company. Moderately higher than the previous round. I mean, you shouldn't be a hater when you ask for your valuation. At the same time, the investor should be looking for all these references, which are two times, three times, with so much potential and all that. I've seen so many strategies that eventually evolved out of this. And in my opinion, stick to your gun. I mean, if the reaction should be lower, then it should be lower. And for the even for the existing shareholders and existing investors in the company. So I would shy away from laying these tricks. Sure, why not?
I want to comment on what you both said. I think that when you look at the growth opportunity, there are two kinds of companies or two kinds of investments. One investment, you say, okay, it's a good company, it's growing, it's not a category leader, the growth is not exponential. With a smart financial engineering formula, I will be able to maintain my multiple. I just need to make sure that I'm the last money in the company, because I'm not the last money in the company, someone else is going to do the same thing to me. This is one thing. Second type is those that are potential category leaders. They are in accelerated growth. There is no chance to get the valuation that you would like to get, and for good reason. Like, you would like to get a smaller valuation for a good reason, because the company is not there yet, but it's in on an accelerated growth traction. And in this case, it's a smart thing to give them a plain vanilla term sheet, because they will require more money in the future, much more money in the future, and you don't want a later stage investor to do the same thing. And I think that what we want to invest in are the second type of companies.
So I'm getting the signal that we're going to run out of time soon. So I actually want to finish with two questions. One is specifically for, let's see why in a minute, but one for Aaron and one for everybody else. And Aaron gets that because he's the non-Israeli in the group, if you will. Aaron, come here, exactly. What he said. So I want to start with you, Aaron, and that is, the premise of both my questions is that Israeli companies in the last few years have gotten much bigger. We've gotten much better in Israel, have grown big companies. It's been getting cliche to say that. People have coined the term, not startup nation, but scale-up nation. There's actually a lawsuit going on and coined the term. But it's the truth. There are 8 or 9 billion-dollar exits with M&A and IPO, and some much bigger than that in the last 12 to 18 months. And that's a great thing. It's a great thing for us. Aaron, you've done some business in Israel, but I'm not going to focus on Israel with you. What I am curious about from you is, what do companies, that, in your experience, not think about well? What do you need to help them with in terms of their hiring plans and their recruiting plans so they can get to those kinds of numbers to that next level?
Companies tend to underhire. I mean, they tend to underestimate. You need to be forward thinking. They see, for instance, the price tag of an experienced executive and get nervous, or the equity requirements, the amount of equity you have to give to a senior person, they get nervous, and they wind up deciding, well, I'm going to go for the young up-and-comer, isn't proven. And that's a great profile, and I would actually argue that on a senior team, you should have a blended portfolio of people, some younger, less experienced folks, and some more seasoned. But a big mistake I see is, by the time they decide they need the experience, it's too late. They hold back, we're going to do it, but it's too early. We want to see, another couple of quarters of revenue. We want to see another year of sustained growth at the levels we have. Once you start thinking about it, you should act.
Mm-hmm. And feel free to comment on that as well. Go ahead, Mark.
Just a comment on that. So sometimes, I agree with what you're saying, but sometimes people might overhire, hiring too many people, but for example, if you open a U.S. subsidiary, I've seen some companies that said, wow, we need to get a Fortune 500 senior executive in here, and then they hire this guy, the head of, president of the U.S. operations, who used to manage thousands of people, and now he has 6 people in his office, and he's not a guy who's been out in the field, and this is really sort of a sales marketing subsidiary. He needs to be out there meeting customers, and he's sitting there drawing org charts in his office. So, he has to be replaced very quickly, and it's hard for him to answer to the CEO of the Israeli company. So I think it's also important when you're building, the U.S. and the European subsidiaries to understand what the purpose of that role is, and it's really more sales and marketing, taking the senior VP from a competitor, who's been out there and knows the customers. It's probably a lot better than being a super senior executive at that point.
I totally agree. And when I say senior, I don't mean they come from a Fortune 500 company. When I mean senior, I mean seasoned, experienced. They've done what you want them to do before, maybe twice or three times. And for whatever reason, they're perverted enough to want to do it again. And you believe that they want to do it again, because that's really important. Because some people have been through the pain of scaling and growing, and they don't want to do it again. Right? And you really have to vet to understand. So once you find people that have that track record, it doesn't, that still doesn't mean you should hire them.
So with that, I wanted to finish up kind of the last question to everybody else, which is, again, we've seen a real positive trend of Israelis and Israeli culture tending more and more towards large companies, which is great for entrepreneurs, great for investors, and great for the ecosystem. Under all that understanding, because when you became a billion-dollar company and half a billion in sales, you were one of a handful, one of the first. In the last couple of years, we've seen many, many more. My question is just very simple. The question is why? Why are we able to do this today in Israel better than we were in the past? And is it sustainable? And how do we make sure it's sustainable?
You know, when we took the company public in 1993, or actually when we raised the money first, as I said, we only used $3.5 million in order to take the company public. There was only one VC in Israel, one VC in Israel. Time. So I think the market changed a lot. Lots of money here, lots of VCs, lots of private equity firms. Situation has completed, and I think people became more mature. I mean, they've seen the experience, the good and bad experience from other companies, and the situation has dramatically changed. So I think we're up to a way better situation probably 10 years from now, based on this.
I think also people are being a lot more patient. Investors, you know, used to want to come in and maybe flip a company quickly. I think now people have a long-term approach and they want to build the fundamentals of the company. And that's helping really build good companies. Also, M&A, as opposed to just being acquired, a lot of Israeli companies are now, you know, we look at companies a lot as platforms where you add on to the companies. And a lot of Israeli companies are actually being acquisitive. And that's helping build, you know, larger companies. And I think a lot of Israelis have spent time in global markets. They've studied and worked overseas. And that's also helped with understanding foreign mentality, customers, you know, as well as knowing better how to build companies. So I think the whole ecosystem has really matured, and that's helping build larger companies.
I think it's first of all, I think it's all over the place. There are an increasing number of companies in Israel that want to be the next step up in the checkpoint. I think there are significantly more companies that want to have an exit as soon as possible because they don't want to be the only parent in Beit Shemesh whose kid hasn't had three exits by the time he's in fourth grade. A lot of that, you know, the patience you're talking about from the funds, on the flip side of that, you know, you are blessed as a result of your incredible record with being able to be patient because your investors are confident and they're not, you know, they aren't demanding an instant return. Whereas many funds are, as soon as they close Fund A, moving to Fund B, and in order to be successful in Fund B, they need to have a certain number of exits. And that creates pressure to exit, as Amiram said, earlier than probably would be optimal.
Great. Well, with that, I'm going to wrap it up. I've been told that if we don't, I'm not going to be part of the company anymore. I want to thank everybody. I can say it's been a pleasure. I've actually worked with every single person up here. It's a pleasure to be with you. Thank you.